Welcome to this 11th podcast in the series on brain development, mental health, and addiction. The series can be accessed via afmc.ca. Throughout this presentation, we will be hearing from some of the leading experts on brain development and addiction medicine from across Canada and the United States, as well as case studies and personal testimonials from professionals struggling with addiction. The podcast will also include a series of reflective questions that will link the specific learning objectives with the Medical Council of Canada objectives for the qualifying examination related to addiction. The MCC objectives are organized around physicians' roles as defined by the CanMeds and CanMeds FMU competency frameworks for undergraduate medical education. Today's topic will be an introduction to system response. We will talk about the principles of chronic disease management, how CDM facilitates the patient-doctor relationship, link patient empowerment to positive patient outcomes, and examine the successes of primary care networks and how their design and principles apply to addiction treatment. The primary goal of chronic disease management is to keep people healthier longer. This model considers the entire patient population, not just those at risk or seeking care. Recent advances in the management of chronic diseases in Canada have been used to help reduce wait times for services, reduce healthcare resource utilization, and improve overall patient health. The key concepts of this approach emphasize the screening and early detection in the entire population, use of interprofessional healthcare teams, supporting patient education and self-care practices, and establishing long-term case management practices. In fact, some of these practices may also help improve the prevention, treatment, and long-term support of individuals with addictions. In the CDM model, patients are screened proactively using case-finding tools to identify those at risk or already with the condition. They are then stratified by risk level and appropriate care is provided in the least resource-intensive setting. The goal is to provide treatment in the community before it has an impact on more complex acute care services. Interprofessional teams provide services and long-term monitoring, with specialists acting as advisors, mentors, and resources for the primary care provider and patient. Integration of care occurs across organizational boundaries and is supported by information systems that allow access to and transfer of key patient data in a timely manner. It should be noted that in this model, it's the primary care physicians who provide and coordinate patient care and are ultimately responsible for patient health. The system supports the primary care physician-patient relationship and supports specialists who in turn support primary care. Dr. Richard Luanchuk is the Chief of Chronic Disease Management for Alberta Health Services. Here, Dr. Luanchuk elaborates on the key principles of CDM in the context of health services in Alberta.
So I'm going to start right off with some of the principles of chronic disease management, principles that we operate under. And one of the first principles is that principle of chronic disease management is that we or whomever, whether it's an individual practitioner, a practice, a clinic, a primary care network in Alberta, a health zone in Alberta, or an entire province, one of the principles is that that provider or provider group or provider organization is responsible for the entire population. Not just the people that show up in the office or just the people that are seeking care, but everybody. And so that implies certain actions, implies that we have to go ferret out people that otherwise wouldn't be seeking care, that can't seek care, that are unable, that don't know. So we need to have those sorts of structures and processes in place. We want to, which leads to the second point, we want to be able to identify people with particular chronic conditions of interest. So case finding, applying screening to find all of the black sheep, so to speak. Another principle of chronic disease management then is as we find these people, we want to stratify them according to level of risk. So either severity of disease or risk of disease and provide care in the least intensive setting possible. So we don't want people with mild high blood pressure needing to go in Edmonton to the Mazankowski Heart Institute or to the Libman Heart Institute in Calgary for treatment of their plain old ordinary high blood pressure. It would be impossible to treat that many people. And similar sorts of things apply in other conditions. So that's why we have family doctors. Primary care is to provide some of that care. And so another principle then is treatment in the community before it impacts on more complex acute care services. So in other words, being able to treat, for example, early diabetes at a primary care level. One of the things I should point out at this point, just before you accuse me of over-medicalizing the model, is that in chronic disease, we also do recognize the role of the individual and the role of the family in healthcare as well, and that'll come up in a moment. But one of the principles of primary care management is that the primary care provider or the primary care team sort of runs the show. They're the quarterback, they coordinate care, and at the end of the day, they're the ones that are responsible. So we don't, although primary care providers may delegate care to specialists, specialty services, they maintain that that coordination and follow a person during their lifetime to keep them as healthy as possible.
It's important to note here that in the chronic disease model, the entire system exists in order to facilitate the patient-doctor relationship. As such, there are a number of key steps to be followed in the CDM process in order for this goal to be achieved. Dr. Luanchuk explains.
Certainly, you would screen and then you'd identify people with your particular chronic condition. So if you're interested in diabetes, how many people are there with diabetes in my individual primary care practice, it would imply systematic screening for everyone, because remember, we're responsible for the whole population, the whole that whole group of my patients as a practitioner, so we'd want to screen and identify people with that particular condition. We would then want to know, we would then want to what we call register a person, so basically create a list so that we now know who those people are and we're not going to lose anybody. They're not going to fall between the cracks in whatever we decide to do with them. We then decide, okay, who's going to do what? Who's on first? Who's on second? So we decide, what is the role of primary care? When might we need specialty care supports? When might we need the specialist? When might we need to access the system? Within our in our provision of care, what does the doctor do? What does a practice nurse do? What does the pharmacist do? What does a physiotherapist do? What does the social worker do? So we determine responsibilities. Then develop sort of care maps, protocols, based on best evidence, although as I'll tell you in a moment, I break out in hives every time I hear the term best practice or best evidence, and I'll tell you why. And then we make sure that people are on these care maps. So we apply the best possible care in a consistent manner, and we make sure that every one of those individuals is managed according to those principles. And then we track people and we remind ourselves, we build in alerts that, okay, it's now 6 months after diagnosis, we need to do these certain things. We need to check for this, we need to check for that, we need to measure this. We then build in measures to tell us, how are people doing? Are we achieving the things we hoped to achieve? In a chronic disease management system, we allow and we build in patient self-management. We help people identify goals. What are your goals for the coming year? What can you work towards? What are the things that you as the person with the disease should be doing or need to be doing? How can we help you in this? What are the community resources? Are there community resources that can be applied?
In chronic disease management, patients are expected to take an active role in their own health care. They are given education, monitoring, and support to adhere to treatment plans and adopt lifestyle changes and self-care behaviors that help maintain health. They are also monitored for barriers to self-management, such as other health conditions, depression, stress, and physical functioning, among other things. Patient outcomes, including self-reported assessments of function, are routinely measured to determine whether the intervention is having the desired effect or whether treatment plans need to be adjusted. Dr. Luanchuk highlights the importance of involving patients in their care.
So one of the other principles then is also involving people in their own care. So healthcare in the olden days used to be something that we healthcare practitioners did to people, and people were passive recipients and really weren't involved in their own healthcare. So as I said a moment ago, we realized that probably 90% of healthcare has nothing to do with healthcare professionals. So when you woke up this morning, you've first of all decided, you know, do you eat breakfast or not? That's a healthcare decision. You're looking after your own healthcare there. What you ate for breakfast was another healthcare decision. If you were driving to work, did you wear your seatbelt? Did you obey the traffic laws? Did you run the yellow light? All of those are healthcare decisions that you make. And then within the family, who's the healthcare provider for the child? Typically the mother, or it may be grandparents, or it may be in extended families, children looking after elderly parents. So there's an awful lot of healthcare that goes on beyond the horizon of what we see as healthcare professionals. So being able to help patients in providing care to themselves and to their families is important. Use of interprofessional teams, so doctors can't do it all, and doctors aren't necessarily the most appropriate healthcare professionals in many, many circumstances to provide care. So now we recognize the value of a whole host of healthcare disciplines in providing care.
Primary care networks have developed rapidly in the last 10 years across Canada. These networks of family physicians are created to increase the proportion of individuals with access to primary care, provide coordinated access to care, improve continuity of care, increase the emphasis on health promotion via disease and injury prevention, and improve integration with other healthcare services. In this sense, primary care networks share many of the same features and goals as the principles of chronic disease management. Dr. Nick Myers, the Medical Director of Primary Care for Alberta Health Services, explains.
What I'd like this group to get out of the talk is an understanding of where the horizon of primary care is and the potential and opportunity that these networks can offer. I don't feel that it is just limited to addiction and mental health or to AHS. I think the discussion needs to involve education, social services. So in listening to this, you know, I'm asking that you think about how this might integrate with what you do and what opportunities there may be and what types of conversations that would need to occur with people who are in primary care networks in your local area. So within these programs, there are strong parallels to chronic disease management. But the chronicity, the need for continuity of care, the need for follow-up, the need for involvement of the whole team, need for self-management, lot of similarities there. And again, within delivering health services, so many similarities from program to program. So that's something we need to remind ourselves of, and we need not reinvent the wheel. There are examples outside.
Family physicians play a critical role in diagnosing addiction and leading a patient toward recovery. Dr. Ray Baker is a physician and the medical director of HealthQuest Occupational Health Corporation, an organization in Vancouver specializing in addiction medicine. Dr. Baker has not only treated thousands of people with addiction, he also overcame his own addiction with drugs and alcohol. Here he talks about how family physicians need to assess and follow up with addicted patients in order to help them manage their recovery.
Physicians can play a profound role one way or the other. So often as an addictions doc, my role was to see somebody in early recovery who's really hurting and give them the message, boy, you're doing well, and I know you're hurting right now, but just because you feel bad doesn't mean you're doing bad. Yes. Keep at it, you know, you're coming along, and that alone is worth a whole lot. But on the other hand, there are certain messages that I can give to sort of deny the existence of this. Maybe I'm uneducated or uncomfortable talking about addiction.
Right.
So I don't bring it up. I give the message that it's no longer an issue.
Right.
Now, if with your hypertension or your diabetes, right, I'll always bring it up. You know, and reinforce the activities you are doing to maintain your remission from whatever chronic disease. But often physicians are uncomfortable bringing that up.
In conclusion, it's important to note that addiction has been recognized as a chronic disease by the 12-step movement for decades, and this view is now becoming mainstream. Despite this, addiction treatment remains reactive and episodic. Applying lessons learned from the chronic disease management model to addiction prevention, intervention, treatment, and follow-up services may help improve the overall health of the population. Dr. Myers notes the important links between addiction and chronic disease management and how these could be implemented in primary care networks.
Well, I think there are various levels of intervention that actually could improve primary care and primary health care. At the level of the medical office, and those levels would be within the medical office, within the PCN and the AHS level. There's the type of the provincial level, and then finally the intersectoral level. But the common theme here is actually about developing partnerships. It's about understanding each other, understanding what each one brings to the table, and how we can work together. So within the office-based setting, and this can be applied to any stream of medicine, whether it's addiction, mental health, chronic disease management, breast health, women's health, men's health. First of all, the need for screening, the early intervention of problems, particularly I think within the addiction and mental health world, that even just the, as we learned on Monday, the asking about early childhood experiences can in itself actually affect some change in patient dependency and perhaps understanding of what's been going on. And you know, should we be looking at a stepwise approach before we send people into the system of these programs? And what can be done, what more could be done within the community so that patients do not hit the acute sector?
So here is a summary of the key points in this podcast. Principles of chronic disease management emphasize screening and early detection in the entire population, use of interprofessional healthcare teams, supporting patient education and self-care practices, and establishing long-term case management practices. CDM provides treatment in the community before it has an impact on more complex acute care services. Patient engagement and empowerment results in positive patient outcomes. Primary care networks empower family physicians to manage patient cases and engage other healthcare professionals, and this model is ideal for application to addiction treatment programs. So as we reach the end of this podcast, here are some reflective questions on the origins of addiction. They are based on the CanMed's competencies and address how you will deal with addiction in your practice. 1. In your role as a medical student or practicing physician, how will you integrate this new knowledge of the principles of chronic disease management as it can be applied to addiction prevention, intervention, and treatment? 2. How can you engage and empower patients to take part in their addiction treatment? 3. What aspects of primary care networks can you employ in your program or practice in order to access treatment options for patients? We hope that you've enjoyed this podcast on system response. We welcome your comments in the feedback section at the bottom of this webpage, and we invite you to continue exploring this series as we examine in more detail the core concepts of early childhood development, as well as the types, causes, and treatment of addiction. This podcast series is based on lectures from the Alberta Family Wellness Initiative, a knowledge mobilization initiative designed to translate scientific research into policy and practice. The podcasts were developed by the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada with guidance from a project advisory committee and produced by Hugh Kellum and Colin McDonald at the University of Ottawa. Narration was done by Hugh Kellum. This project was sponsored by the Norlene Foundation. The complete podcast series can be accessed via afmc.ca.